another restaurant is born. Right at the front of the train is the only deluxe coach on the Peruvian railways, and the only bit of the train, funnily enough, not made in Sheffield. It's comfortable, full of varnish and leather, and if you sit up, you can just about see out of the window. And what you see is a plain which in prehistoric times was covered by a huge lake. Now it's a cold, high plateau on which nothing much thrives except woolly animals and potatoes. We're heading along, still at about 13,000 feet, towards Puno, where we'll arrive under cover of darkness. Nighttime, Puno, and ahead of us lies the remnants of that prehistoric lake, still over 100 miles of it. For once, our destination isn't a station, it's a quayside and a steamer. You won't find a steamer anywhere higher than this. Lake Titicaca is the highest navigable lake in the world at 12,500 feet. Also, an international frontier between Peru and Bolivia. The Ollanta was built in Hull in 1930 and rebuilt all over again in Puno. There was a scientific expedition here from Cambridge in 1937. I'm beginning to get the feeling that I'm in a little outpost of England, or England perhaps as it used to be, all varnished wood and polished brass. I'm in good hands tonight. Machinery from Gateshead. Personal hygiene by Shanks. Water purified by something from the Victoria and Albert Museum. Everything laid on to make sure that I get an early bed so that I'll be up at the crack of dawn, ready to catch the sunrise. Thank you. We're in Bolivian waters now, land of Butch Cassidy and revolutions. They've had over a revolution a year ever since the country became independent. They've also fought several wars, and each time have lost territory. Once they had a seacoast. Now all they've got is half Lake Titicaca. But they're proud people, and the Bolivians still have a navy. For a lover of steam, this place is a paradise to stand and stare in. Not today, though, because we've been unofficially told that there's trouble brewing, and it'd be best to get through customs as quickly as possible. What kind of trouble? Nobody seems to know. All we know is that it's worth bribing your way onto the train to La Paz. The rail car is just big enough for half the passengers from the boat. Those of us who get onto it will be able to get to the capital, in safety, only 50 miles away. Those left behind will have to do the best they can. Somebody who's been listening to the radio says that the military have been putting out appeals for law and order. That's a sure sign that law and order is breaking down. But those who know the country say that things will be all right if we get through to La Paz.
We don't really get into trouble unless it was a really serious civil war. But if not, you just hear the next morning on the papers there's been a coup d'etat, what they call a golpe, and the military take over the government. But it never affects you really.
Well, yeah, we're traveling into a train in La Paz now, aren't we? Yeah. They say there's going to be a general strike at 3 o'clock and the military are going to come out.
Yeah. Well, let's hope we get there in time, because it would be very serious. Because they block the roads, and sometimes the engines throw stones on the lorries and cars. Yeah.
And the trains as well?
I don't know about the trains, because it's the first time I'm travelling in train in Bolivia. But I hope that it will be the best for us to get back to La Paz in time.
Que está integrado por altos dirigentes de la Confederación de Fabriles, hace un llamado a todos los compañeros trabajadores, a todas las fuerzas revolucionarias, para que en ningún momento se dejen confundir por ciertos rumores.
Well, everyone's worst fears have been justified. The military have taken over, the workers have hit back with a call for a general strike. Sooner or later, the two sides are going to come to blows, and we're stuck in a one-horse town called Viacha. Well and truly stuck, because now a train has been derailed right in front of us. It could take hours to get it back on the line. We have to sit here waiting and waiting for something to happen. And if so, what? As I said, the one thing I knew about South America when I got here was to look out for revolutions. You're looking at one. Inside that rail car, there are 12 French tourists debating what to do next. They've just voted to stay put till they're rescued. But rescued by who? One thing I've learned is that when a train breaks down in South America, you don't wait for the next train or for the 7th Cavalry. You just carry on the best you can.
Hey,
Only 20 miles to La Paz, though it seems like 200. I just keep telling myself that La Paz, in Spanish, means peace.